Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. You know, one of the chapters in this long history of Jews in the Italian peninsula that I find most fascinating is the period known as the Risorgimento, or the unification of Italy. This is a period when there was an unusual coming together of the politically active movement for reform in Italy with the Jewish population of some 30,000, who began to see that they had a lot in common and that they could, in fact, work together very effectively to bring the peninsula into the modern world. And let's look just for a few minutes at that unusual chapter in Italian Jewish history. Here's a map of Italy at the end of the 18th century, and as you can see, it's fragmented into tiny little kingdoms and duchies and republics, the papal states right there in the middle, and all of this changed dramatically with the entry of Napoleon. Here you can see a fantastic image of Napoleon by the incredible historical painter Jacques-Louis David. This is Napoleon crossing the Alps, and in his very heroic way, he sought to bring the ideals of the French Revolution to the rest of Europe, whether they liked it or not. And one of the areas where he was especially proud of having an impact was in his impact on the Jewish populations. He would come into all of these towns that he conquered, and he would break down the ghetto walls with great ceremony, or ghetto gates at any rate. And, you know, this was celebrated for the most part with tremendous excitement by Jews who saw him as a harbinger of modernity, as someone who was willing to grant Jews equality after all of the disabilities that they had suffered, including the humiliating Jewish badge, the restriction to ghettos, the closure from almost all institutions of higher education, and so on and so forth. Here's an image which we've seen in other contexts of Napoleon granting equality to Judaism. Here he is in a kind of Caesarian look, but with the Judean desert in the background, and he's lifting up the fallen woman that represents Judaism. There's a lot of fascinating things to say about Napoleon and his relationship to Jews and so on. This was very upsetting to the church in general, not only because of the Jews, of course, but because of all the secular influences that Napoleon and the French Revolution were bringing with them. Here's an image of Pius VI, the Pope at the time, actually Pope for quite a long time, one of the longest reigning popes. And just before Napoleon's entry, he issued something called the Editto sopra gli Ebrei, the edict regarding the Jews, and it reads like something straight out of the Middle Ages. The Jews have to stay in the ghettos, they have to keep wearing the badges, they're not allowed to study the Talmud, all kinds of nasty things. And it seemed like the papal states in particular were going to hearken back to the darkest period of the Dark Ages vis-a-vis the Jews. We would see that as well later in Bologna, for example, with the horrible Mortara affair that we've spoken about on this channel. But when Napoleon came in, he actually occupied Rome in 1798. They proclaimed a republic, and Pius VI was actually arrested. The thing is, the story is not like one sort of continuous movement towards emancipation of the Jews and the introduction of, you know, a secular state and so on. Because from that time until late in the 19th century, you have this pendulum swing between, you know, the sort of radical introduction of reform and then a reactionary snapback where all kinds of, you know, restrictions are placed on the Jews along with other restrictions society as well. So it was a very difficult time for about, you know, 70 odd years where much of the Italian peninsula was swinging back and forth between a dizzying array of social legislation. There's another historian on YouTube named Sam Arano who does some fantastic work, and he has a really great video that summarizes the dizzying array of changes that happened in the 19th century. I'll put that particular link in the notes. You should have it. Look at that if you want to look a little more deeply into the whole process of Italian emancipation of Jews. In this context, you begin to have the Italian liberation movement, which is personified with the idea of unification. One of the most important figures is Giuseppe Mazzini, shown here. And what's not as well known, particularly outside of Italy, is the fact that he had early on very important Jewish supporters. One of them that's most significant is Sarina Levi Natan, a woman who was born in Pesaro but lived in England. And she was a huge supporter of Mazzini, and they had lots of dialogue about what the whole point of Italian unification was for. It was not only to bring together, you know, this linguistically diverse area into one political system. It was really to promote a lot of the values that she associated with modernity, including emancipation of Jews, and also, incidentally, including emancipation of women. This became a very early idea in the Young Italy movement, and the whole idea of Risorgimento was associated with bringing all levels of society up to the same bar of equality. Ultimately, this would happen over the course of the 1850s through the 70s. You can see here in this map how it slowly came to be from one territory to another. And in this context, Italians of all faiths, and especially Jews, were totally involved with the idea of bringing together a patriotic movement into the future. A couple of the more important leaders include Daniele Manin, who was actually the leader of Venice for some time, came from a Jewish ancestry, and ultimately the Jewish Luigi Luzzatti, who was even elected prime minister of Italy, one of the earliest Jews ever to be elected to a European state as its prime leader. Fascinating. This coming together of all Italians, and especially Italian Jews, would be particularly fascinating when we get to the 20th century and we see the growth of fascism under Mussolini. We're not going to talk about it in this short video, but it is kind of surprising that Jews actually in Italy were big supporters of fascism because it was seen as the patriotic thing to do. Lots more to say about that, but for now, thank you very much for watching this short video.